Welcome back to talknorth.com. Thank you for listening. If you can, please download before you listen. It helps our business. I'd also like to thank our producer, Brandon Morton, and let you know if you'd like to sponsor this program or any of the programs on the network, you can reach me at jsouhan47@gmail.com. TalkNorth.com is powered by Bite Squad. Go to BiteSquad.com or download their app. Get food to your door in minutes. Use the promo code TALKNORTH to get your first delivery free. Talk North gets you your first delivery free. I'm beginning to suspect Matt Patricia is an idiot. And I usually don't, you know, I try not to call people names. It's too easy. But my God, this guy, you know, he rides Belichick's coattails like so many other assistants. He gets a head coaching job like so many of Belichick's assistants. And like so many of Belichick's assistants, he immediately demonstrates he really doesn't know what he's doing. Listen, I'm willing to be hard on Zimmer when I think he gets outcoached. Yesterday, Zimmer and his staff ran circles around Matt Patricia.
And I hope you're sitting up straight in your chair while you're saying all this.
Oh, well, you know, posture is very important when you're destroying a football franchise.
You know, here's the thing that really almost entertained me, but kind of made me question what Patricia's about. When he's down with about a minute to go and decides to kick a field goal, you're kind of just waving the flag there. You're inside right. The red zone. You're waving the flag. And then you come back and you're calling timeouts at the end to, you know, to save time for whatever reason.
So you can kick another field goal.
But that part was ridiculous to me. The whole game, the way it shook out, though, I put a lot of what happened on Matthew Stafford and the offensive line. But you also wonder how much of a hangover there was from the Golden Tate trade, where, you know, Stafford looked like he was lost anytime his first read wasn't open and he didn't know where to go with it. And I wonder how much of that had to do with Golden Tate being such a safety valve for him over the past several years that he just missed that element. And how much is that going to screw up the Lions team for years to come?
I say a lot. I'm gonna put it in scientific terms. A lot, Tim. A lot. He's Tim Yotter. He's publisher of Viking Update, vikingupdate.com. He's the dad mode guy with the dad jokes. So we'll get to all the dad jokes here shortly. This is the Viking Update show, one of our football shows, our most popular show on talknorth.com. Also recommend Jeff Diamond's NFL and Vikings and NFL Insider, which is also on this network, talknorth.com. But this is kind of the one when this is the show where we really break down the Vikings to a granular level, and Tim is perfectly suited to do that. We've been covering the Vikings since the 90s, not together, but parallel, I think is the right way to put it. Thanks to our sponsors, WizKids.tech, Twill in the Edina Galleria, Mississippi Pub, Beaver Island Brewing, BiteSquad.com, FixologyRepair.com, and Tony Hoagland, your State Farm agent in Champlin. Thanks to our producer, Brandon Morton. Please remember, download before you listen if you can. It's a better listening experience. And if you'd like to advertise with this program or anywhere across the network, which had 145,000 listens last month, you can reach me at jsouhan47@gmail.com. And I love the fact it was the Detroit News actually used the headline, Poor Posture.
Yeah. It was perfect. And, you know, the Lions played into it with the game starting with them kicking off and Matt Prater slipping on the kickoff and falling on his back. And then the picture that they had of Matthew Stafford being sacked and his back all bent over and twisted. You know, the whole thing really played into the ability to poke fun at Patricia last week. And for people who don't know, during a press conference last week, Matt Patricia interrupted a reporter and said, you know, hey, can you sit up, please? Can you have better posture and all that sort of thing? And it was just a strange moment. And, you know, after Mike Zimmer stopped mid question to talk about reporters typing during his press conference, It got labeled very aptly by your colleague Ben Gessling as the Manners Bowl on Sunday. So I was kind of entertained by the whole thing. You know, a couple of of coaches that were kind of in bad moods last week, and Zimmer was in a terrific mood after the game on Sunday. As good as I've seen him in a long, long time.
And he should have been, because again, I do think they outcoached the Lions badly. The Lions had only given up like 13 sacks coming into this game, and the Vikings come up with 10. Danielle Hunter, 3.5 on his own. And I think the Lions thought that they could find a way to take deep drops and hit Marvin Jones and Kenny Galladay downfield. And the Vikings gave them absolutely no chance. And stopping the run was a big part of that. If Kerryon Johnson had gotten it going, maybe play action would have worked. Instead, the Lions were exposed for being silly to get rid of Golden Tate. I still don't understand that trait. Unless you're really not trying to win, unless Patricia's talked them into some kind of a five-year plan, this team's been competitive and close to the playoffs and in the playoffs. Golden Tate's one of their best players, and they trade him away when they're still in the race. I don't get it.
Well, to me, that kind of signaled we aren't convinced that we are good enough to get to the playoffs, because if you're trading Golden Tate, and I think it was the final year of his contract, I'm not 100% sure on that, but
it was,
I believe so.
Yes. Yeah.
And okay, so you're getting something from him, but you also could have gotten something in a compensatory pick as well if he goes somewhere else after the season. And you know, to me it really was a signal that if we're trading what at least I view to be their best receiver for that offense right now, you know, I think Golden Tate had the ability to open up what Kenny Galladay was doing. And I really liked right. what Kenny Galladay was doing coming into this game. But you saw that the Vikings felt they could just give more attention to Galladay. You know, with Marvin Jones, they just had Xavier Rhodes shadowing him around most of the game. When Rhodes was out dealing with his foot injury, then the Vikings stayed on their sides with Holton Hill and Trey Waynes. But you know, to me, it really did signal we don't think we're good enough to get to the playoffs this year, so we're going to trade one of our best offensive players.
This network has grown dramatically. It's fun to work with other Minneapolis companies that have grown dramatically. WhizKids.tech, WHIZKIDS.tech. They now have a cool billboard on Washington Avenue. They're a downtown Minneapolis company that has grown fast. Let them be your chief technology ally.
Hello, Minnesota sports fans. This is Michael Fanner, founder and CEO of WizKids. WizKids is a Minneapolis-based managed IT, hosted VoIP, and cloud services provider. Businesses today require fast response times, skilled support staff, clear communication, and technology recommendations that align with their business goals. At WizKids, we do this each and every day with our clients. When you call into our help desk for support or work with one of our higher-level engineers on a complex issue, you'll find our staff personable and ready to roll up their sleeves to help you solve your technology problems. Reach out to WizKids today to find out how we can help your business meet your technology goals. Visit us online at WizKids.tech. That's WizKids.tech. WizKids, make it happen.
Danielle Hunter was the story of the game. 3.5 sacks, which is a season for a lot of people. A scoop and a score. And, you know, you're reminded talking to him after the game just how humble and how pleasant a guy he is. He looks like he wants, you know, you look at him, he looks like he could rip your head off. He looks like a cartoon character, but he's just the nicest guy.
Yeah, I mean, he's amazingly chiseled. It's been a long time since I've seen an athlete that is, you know, I guess, lean but muscular. You know, there's no real body fat there. You know, some of the others, I guess, in history would be to a smaller, lesser degree, a Robert Griffith. He was always in great shape as a safety.
Right. But he was like a mini Hunter. Hunter's like,
yes.
I mean, I've never seen anybody that big, that chiseled, and yet that lean and that fast. I've just never seen that combination before.
Yeah. And you know, we've heard stories of him keeping up with running backs during offseason workouts when they're doing sprints. He is, you know, he's got the long arms. He's really just starting to put it all together from, you know, I think he was a guy that came in and you looked at him and said, boy, he's got all the physical attributes. But as Mike Zimmer said, I believe part of what has gotten him to the point that he is at this year with 11.5 sacks and leading the NFL is that he is playing a little bit more free, trusting himself on what he's seeing and going after it But he is also, you know, a lot of times you get these defensive ends, the pass rushers, that all they want to do is rush the quarterback, and they're not trying to read the play as much. And there are times where you see him start to rush the quarterback, realize that there's a running back coming out toward his side for a little check down pass, and he'll get over there and either chase down the running back or get in the throwing lane and make a difference. So he's absolutely the type of guy you want. He's got the physical attributes. He's got the mental, the understanding of the game, and he's a team player. He's not just going after the sack stats. He's playing things the way that they're called and reading things at the way they should be.
Everson Griffin was saying, yeah, God, I wish I'd been that coachable when I was young. I would have made it faster. And I don't think he was joking. I think he was actually serious. I was talking to Stephen Weatherly, and I asked him, you know, what he thinks when he just looks across the locker room and sees Danielle Hunter. And that's when he gave me the quote that I used in my column that I think everybody else ended up latching onto too, which is, man, his parents did a great job putting that guy together.
I know. It was a tremendous quote. It's, you know, it's one of the reasons that Weatherly has really stepped to the forefront as a guy that people love talking to, but, you know, he's absolutely right with everything that Danielle Hunter brings to the table from a physical standpoint. I mean, he kind of looks like a Greek god out there. And as you mentioned though, he also looks like the guy, if you put a suit coat on him and a briefcase on him, you wouldn't, you know, you would think he belongs in an office building too, because he's just so well spoken and humble. He's not, you know, this hyper over the top, look at me type of guy. And, you know, the Vikings, you've got to give them credit on this one, as we have in so many other cases with contract extensions, getting the guy signed before everybody else would have realized how immense his value is.
Absolutely. And it was interesting to hear how many defensive linemen mentioned Andre Patterson and Hunter, again, being the humble guy he is, kept mentioning Andre Patterson. You know, Jeff Diamond and I have talked about it on that show, how, you know, Jeff got to know Andre back in the 90s, and he's been doing this a long time. He's very incredibly well-respected around the league, and he has remained in the NFL. He's remained a defensive line coach. And, you know, you wonder, okay, he's a really good defensive line coach. Should he have been a coordinator at some point? But sometimes the right career path is doing what you're really good at and just continuing to do it.
Yeah, and in talking to him, I think it was last year at one point, you know, I just got the feeling like he is very comfortable with where he's at in his career. He loves to take young projects and turn them into great players. And he's done it time and again, especially since coming back to the Vikings. You know, to me, I guess I'm so ingrained with a defensive line coach is often this hyper guy that is sort of that eat nails type of attitude with his players. And Andre Patterson just isn't that. He's constantly just working on techniques, very low key. To me, he's kind of that consummate teacher where he just wants to bring you aside and show you what to do, the right hand movements, how to read things. He kind of goes against what people view as a stereotypical defensive line coach.
Right. A lot of defensive line coaches are considered to be yellers, and Patterson's much more of a teacher. Spent Saturday out at Twill at the Dining Galleria. I do go there myself and spend my own money. And I bought a bunch of stuff this time around. Anytime I go there with Stacey, I end up spending a lot of money. Bought a Storm System cap. So it looks like just like a nice generic, you know, baseball cap, but it's got like very subtle ear flaps that pull down so you can walk your dog and not freeze. It's actually insulated inside. Bought some Stenstrom shirts. I've already bought Millar and Johnny O and Barber stuff there. They have a bunch of new gifts in that'll be perfect for Christmas. We're going to do a new ad highlighting a lot of the new stuff. All we can tell you is we spend our money there. I recommend going to Twill in the Dining Galleria.
Jim usually doesn't like to shop for clothes. I don't like it when he shops for clothes either, because he used to buy stuff I'd want to throw out. That's why I'm so glad he's found Twill in the Dining Galleria. He likes shopping there because of the comfortable environment and the friendly staff. He finds clothes that actually fit in properly and are high quality brands that will look great for years, whether he's golfing or working. Our favorites so far are Peter Millar, Johnny O, and Barber. We spend our money at Twill because we love